first generation Xeons, or you can call them generation 1.5 because they're on Westmere architecture, which is 32 nanometer, when the first generation i7s, for example, were actually 45 nanometer. Anyway, these Xeons, they're going on AliExpress for around $15 shipped, and you can get your choice of a 4-core, 8-threaded CPU that clocks about 3.5 gigahertz out of the box, or you can get the X5670, which clocks to around 3 gigahertz, but that's got 6 cores and 12 threads versus the X5677, which has 4-core, 8-threads. However, are these CPUs worth it? And especially if you're on a budget, are they going to give you a decent gaming experience even in 2021? There's lots to discuss on this topic, so let's get on into it.
How? I've got money and I love spending it. Well, if you've got money and you love spending it, then the Z590 Steel Legend Wi-Fi 6E from ASRock is the motherboard of choice for you. With support for the upcoming 11th gen Intel CPU processors and having additional features like the Dragon 2.5 gigabits per second NIC and the ASRock graphics card holder, which works off the motherboard itself regardless of the case you have, and that cool, smooth camouflage aesthetic. Links in description below to find out more. The Xeons, the first generation. People are telling me, Brian, you've got to move on from these Xeons. And I will move on. I will, look, I'm the first that'll move on. I'll say, in the future, if things are that bad for these Xeons, I will move on. Don't get me wrong. When the time comes, I will move on. But as long as they're $15 shipped worldwide and there's plenty in stock, I think I'm not going to move on for the time being. But you're probably wondering, with these older Xeons, what are the drawbacks? Who are these for? Let's discuss right here, right now, where we'll pull up some results here with, say, the 4-core, 8-threaded X5677 versus the X5670. Now, what you'll see here is that they're pretty much performing very similar across the board. And in fact, the X5677 will win out in some titles, both with an RX 570 and also the RTX 3060 Ti. So first here, we'll look at CSGO, where this was the biggest difference that I saw between these two CPUs. Out of the box, of course, you can overclock both these CPUs if you've got an overclocking platform, but as we covered in yesterday's video, I'll put the link up here, we talked about the Jingxia motherboards, where they're going for $50, but on these motherboards, you just don't want to overclock, period. If anything, you want to undervolt on these motherboards to increase the longevity of them. And so, and of course, increase the longevity of your CPU. Though the big difference is here, you got 4 cores, 8 threads on the 5677, and then you got 6 cores on the X5670, which is kind of weird, right? You think, oh, okay, the higher number should dictate the better CPU. But the thing about the X5677 is it's clocked higher out of the box. And since we generally don't want to overclock on these cheaper motherboards, this can give you higher FPS in certain games. And so we've got 3.46 to around 3.6 gigahertz on the 4 cores, 8 threads versus 2.9-ish to 3.06 on the 6 cores, 12 threads. And where the 6 cores wins out, of course, is that Cinebench score. We're looking at over 1,400 points versus 1,084. So basically, if the games support perfect cores, or at least basically perfect separation of thread load between 6 cores, 12 threads versus 4 cores, 8 threads, then that game is gonna see a benefit, providing your GPU's not getting maxed out on the 6 cores, 12 threads. Then moving over to Fortnite, we pretty much saw identical FPS here, which was good to see that this game does support more cores, more threads at lower clock speeds. So having that 6 core Xeon isn't gonna be a detriment versus the 4 core. And then moving over to Doom Eternal, we saw here that the 6 core edged out the 4 core, meaning Doom Eternal was doing a great job of utilizing those extra cores and extra threads. Doom Eternal, I would expect no less from, where the makers of Doom have really optimized this game for PC pretty much perfectly. And that you can even have like 16 cores, 32 threads, if you've got the right GPU, getting perfectly synchronized there. They're all in harmony on this game. And that's where the FPS increase comes from, having more cores, more threads. Now, moving over to F1 2020, we saw pretty similar results here, 133 versus 137. 128 on the RX 570 versus 139. So we were edging things out on the 6-core when it came to the RX 570. And I have seen these discrepancies pop up in the results here today between the RX 570 and the 3060 Ti. And that was one thing that's, maybe the AMD stuff is working a little bit better nowadays on the older hardware. So that was pretty good to see. Though when it comes to gaming, the interesting thing was we had around the same power usage from the wall, 292 watts versus 287, and this was in Doom Eternal. So basically the higher core count, lower clocked Xeon will use slightly less power when it comes to gaming. So that was pretty good to see that maybe the sweet spot for these older Xeons was indeed around 3 GHz, where as you start upping the clock speeds, you start hitting that inefficiency of power consumption versus speeds. And so that's pretty much existent on all CPUs. Though those results aside, we did throw in the overclocked X5670 for you guys, as well as the 10900K in today's results, just to give you an idea of how much FPS you'd be missing out on, say an RX 570 or a 3060 Ti. And the good thing is here, just like we said in the motherboard video yesterday, you're not missing out on a whole lot when you go with a RX 570, which is, I'm gonna say, going into the next few months is gonna be a very popular card to get, because we discussed all the merits in this current terrible market of GPU purchasing. We discussed why the 4 GB cards are probably going to be your best play. And so these Xeons, they still do a good job of coupling up with budget graphics cards and giving you a decent playable experience. Now, there are some titles, and now this is the biggest thing about these old Xeons, is not only their age, right? Yes, they could drop out on you in a couple of months, especially if they've been used heavily for years and years and years. That is a risk you're taking. And then on AMD, of course, Ryzen, etc. carries AVX2. So the fact that these older Xeons don't even carry AVX2, the first generation, I believe, doesn't even have AVX, where the second and third generation Intel CPUs carried AVX. So you're missing out on AVX and AVX2. And so some games, for instance, Horizon Zero Dawn, they won't even boot. They won't even play because they don't have these newer instruction sets. But here's the thing. The games that we tested here today, CSGO, Fortnite, Doom Eternal even worked, F1 2020. These games all worked fine on this first generation Xeon. And another thing is too, is if we go and look at say Dota 2 or all these games that people are playing right now, they're very popular multiplayer titles. You can be rest assured that a lot of these games are going to work on this older hardware. And you're probably thinking, well, why is that? Shouldn't we be moving towards better graphics, better efficiency, and better optimization? And the truth is that game developers want as many people playing their games as possible, especially if they foresee it being a very popular multiplayer title. So they're going to optimize for pretty much any hardware out there because they want ultimately more players, which means more customers, more money. And so what you're going to see with these first generation Xeons is if you're into playing a lot of these multiplayer titles, which me personally, I started playing StarCraft 2 the other day, and I think I've gotten much more game time out of that than say Cyberpunk 2077. Look, don't get me wrong, I really enjoyed playing through Cyberpunk 2077, but for me, there was no after game. After I finished it, there's no continuancy there. I just sort of played it, clocked it, loved it, and then I haven't played it since. I don't even have the desire to get to level 50. And so I just sort of let that sit, where I'm enjoying these popular multiplayer titles a lot more. And in the case of StarCraft 2, I'm really enjoying that. I've got back into it, and they've made a lot of changes to the game since I last played. And I was like, okay, cool. Battle cruises, teleporting and stuff. This is what I want to be doing. And those games play absolutely fine on these first generation Xeons. So I know there's the crowd out there that's like, look, it's time to move on. And I get you guys. But this is the thing. I know a lot of my audience out there, you guys come from places where you don't have a minimum wage like we do in Australia, where in Australia we've got like a minimum wage that's close to $20 an hour, which that's Aussie dollars. If we adjust that for USD, that's around 16 United States dollars an hour, or 15. That's really healthy. That's a really high standard worldwide. So even if you just got your first job and you're really young, you still can be earning good money to afford that newer and latest, greatest and stuff. But if you're living in a country where you aren't as fortunate as us guys in Australia, then you might not be able to afford all that latest and greatest hardware. So there is that crowd there. And I do always think about you guys when I talk about these CPUs. And so I'm going to put this out on the table. If you can go get a new Ryzen chip or a new Intel 10th gen, go do it. If you can afford that, great. Or if you can go get a really good deal on used Ryzen where you are locally, then go do that. I'm not here to say don't do it. Like, of course, if it exists where you are, then go do it. But the problem is that it doesn't exist everywhere in the world. And this channel, last time I checked, a lot of you guys love this older stuff, and we are a pretty global community here. So I don't like to overlook what this stuff can offer. I never overlook that. And we look at that CPU, I can get it shipped to Australia in Aussie dollar terms, probably about 20 something dollars. And when I look at the cheapest Ryzen available locally here, even like a used Ryzen 3 1200, it's probably gonna set me around $80. Am I going to get four times the price performance of this older Xeon? No. And so of course, even in a first world country, if you don't want to spend pretty much anything on a computer, you want to get just a budget system and just play some games, you can still do that with this stuff right here. Especially if you're building your first PC and you might make some mistakes, you might bend a few pins, you're scared of that. This stuff is good to practice on too. It's never going to hurt anyone, especially if you just want a backup PC as well. Say for instance, you hate having downtime with your PC, something goes wrong in a lightning storm or something and you want to have a backup PC. This one's ready to go and it'll still give you the FPS. But ultimately, all PC parts are good, just depends on the price. And I mean, people out there, well, Bulldozer. Nah, Bulldozer's all right as well. I've tried Bulldozer in the past, the old FX AMD chips. They can still get up and boogie as well and give you an enjoyable experience. Anyway, guys, at the end of the day, the price of these CPUs and the FPS numbers they can deliver, that's gonna do all the talking. And pretty much, are these Xeons still relevant? The answer is yes. I was actually like, I came into this year with an open mind and looking at the situation where I personally was kind of going to move on from X58 until I tried these budget new motherboards. And then I saw the prices of those Xeons. I thought, okay, is this thing going to actually suck that bad to the point where I wouldn't recommend it? But then I tried out the motherboard and I was actually pleasantly surprised. And so that's sort of like given these older Xeons a new breath of fresh air, a new breath of life, which me personally, I am happy to see. Anyway, guys, with that aside, I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you did, be sure to hit that like button for us. Also, let us know in the comment section below, what do you think of the first generation Xeons? Do you think if the price is right, they're still worth a crack? Or do you think you should just forget the price completely and just move into that upper echelon of Ryzen CPUs? Love reading those thoughts and opinions as always, just like this question of the day here, which comes from Ping Yu. And they ask, I've got the exact same PC and it's amazing, but I've got a crappy graphics card in it and I'm going to get the ASUS 710. Will it work? I mean, if you're talking about a GTX 710, it'll work. But it just, this is the thing about these 710 cards and also GTX, I think they're the GT, they're not even GTX, sorry. GT 710, GT 210, GT 610. They are like the crappiest graphics cards in history for playing games. They're pretty much intended for office PCs where people just need a display and that's it. I mean, you might be lucky to watch 1080p movies on them as well, but in terms of getting anything gaming, in terms of the fact that you said crappy graphics card, a GT 710 is also a crappy graphics card for gaming. Don't do that to yourself. You want at least a GTX 750 at the bare minimum to give you some FPS. And the main thing is just to, you can just Google that graphics card as well and the title you want to play and the numbers should come up nowadays. Google is a mad search engine as well as YouTube. You can pretty much find the FPS numbers you're looking for because someone out there's done a video on it. So that's a good thing, but I'm just telling you now, GT 710 is not going to be giving you pretty much a gaming experience on any. It might be able to do RuneScape, the web-based RuneScape, who knows. But I haven't tried that personally, but might be able to do that. But in terms of being a crappy graphics card, it's pretty up there in terms of being a crappy graphics card. Hope that answers that question. And I'll catch you guys in another tech video very soon. And also, if you stayed this far and you're enjoying that Tech Yes content, be sure to hit that sub button, ring that bell. And I'll catch you in the next one very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.